Kilter Fudge Double Chocolate Stout. A rich, luscious chocolate dessert stout brewed with caramel and chocolate. Caramel and chocolate malts, pure Ecuadorian cacao nibs, milk, sugar, and vanilla. Yeah, there is a lot of chocolate in there, which you would expect from something called the double chocolate stout. But it's not enough, it's not so much chocolate that it's killing off the malt taste, though there is still a really nice strong malt taste behind that. So today, I thought I would do a teardown of this. Oh, this is going to be interesting. This is an ADC remote terminal network, piece of telephone equipment. It uses lasers. So this is from October 1997, it's manufactured date, so 22 years old, okay. As with all telecom equipment, it runs off, well, almost all telecom equipment runs off minus 48 volts DC, Hertz DC, zero phases, part number and serial number again. 43rd week of 1997, which comes pretty darn close to October. ADC Telecommunications, Minnetonka, Minnesota. Let's go and talk about those guys for just a second while I rearrange the camera so you can get a better view of this thing. So the first thing I notice here, ADC Telecommunications was, past tense, communication company Eden Prairie, Minnesota, suburb of Minneapolis. And I know there's a few people around Minneapolis that that watch my channel occasionally because they've commented on other things that came from that general area. Seems to have been a bit of a high-tech hub at one point in history down there. Anyway, so the company started in 1935 and defuncted in 2010 when they were bought out by a company that eventually became CommScope, who has bought all kinds of stuff in the telecom world. You ever seen an antenna with a big red lightning bolt on it? That was Andrew Antennas that have been huge forever. CommScope bought them as well a bunch of years ago. Anyway, that's a digression. So these guys, they were big in a lot of other sort of cross-connect and patch stuff, including fiber patch bays and patch panels and stuff like that, until whatever happened in, you know, all kinds of acquisitions. You can read it on the Wikipedia page here. Anyway, I've encountered through my career a whole bunch of stuff that they've made. And it's a bit of a pain in the ass now that they got bought out and a lot of their product lines have been shut down. So you can't get expansions for a lot of these old systems anymore, which is really annoying. Unless you buy them from sort of third-party resellers or whatever.
Well, I think that's as good a view as you're going to get of this thing. Unfortunately, my workbench is a little bit too small for stuff like this, but whatever, we'll make do. And I hope you can hear me okay, too. So from the front panel, so this thing, first of all, this thing is a remote terminal. It's designed to be installed in a customer's location, which means you don't want your customers messing around with it. So, to proceed with this teardown, or investigation, I'm going to have to use some other skills here. Well, that was fairly easy to get inside. So, this particular unit's only equipped with a couple of different cards. And we'll pop them out in a second. Basically, QLX is a quad loop extender is what it's called, and the APU is an alarm processor unit. So basically this is the one that actually does the transport of the signal from the central office or wherever to the customer's location, and this thing basically just monitors it and makes sure it's all happy. Now then, these two side panels pull off. And they're locked down by the cover when the cover's on. And on, you see the cabling came out there. But on this side and on the other side too, there's these little things here which are fiber management. So the fiber can come in either down there or down here. There's a little channel cut out of the corners of these covers, and then it can just loop around there to eat up excess length, but not get kinked by making too tight of bends. It's fiber optics, it's glass, so it can't bend at an infinitely fine radius. It needs a certain care and handling kind of thing. So that's what those guys are on the sides there. And then this top cover, looks like it's got a couple of screws here. Okay, top cover comes off. I think we saw everything that's there. So there is some other fiber management. The fiber will come in through here from those little slack loops in through there and just hang through these and come down to the card. It'll actually come down through that slot in there and go onto the card. And again, you just want to be really gentle with fiber. So what do we got back there? Okay, what do we have here? We have four cables. So I guess I didn't really mention it before. This thing was being used to carry four T1s to a customer's location from some remote location, either the telephone central office or another office location of the company where this thing was installed. And it was using fiber to do that, and then its output is four T1 signals, four T1 carriers, I guess. T1 being 1.544 megabits per second data signal or data path. And this one has four of them coming out. There's the four of them there. And this particular one also has the ground wire up there. I'm just going to chop these off because we're never going to use this thing again. I'm just going to get these out of the way. So each of the T1s is a four wire balanced signal or balanced connection. Two wires for transmit, two wires for receive. And that's how they've got them wired up here. Further, each of the wires is designated as a tip or ring. I think you can just barely see it on there. The ring is on top and the tip is on the bottom. That goes back to the quarter inch jacks that they used for patching. Tip and ring, same as this little guy, only, you know, full size, and sleeve being the ground. Same thing here, tip and ring. And then the orange is the output from this, and the blue is the input. That's kind of arbitrary, but you just, because the out of this equipment goes to the in of another piece of equipment, which one is, you know, you just choose and stay consistent on your site. So there's that breakout board. This breakout board has enough positions for eight T1s. So you could use, with this breakout board, you could use two, zoom out, you could use two of these QLX cards. And you would put the second one over in this side, because the one that goes beside this one would be used as a standby. And then there'll be working in a standby here as well. Potentially, you could get to that level. This one was just using a single card, unprotected. Is you want protection, you got to pay for it. You got to pay for every added option. So the other things that are going on back here, let me zoom back in. So we have power, and this one did have two power feeds. Those power feeds on this particular one were coming from actually that Lorraine power module that I did a teardown on several months back. I'll put a link up there as usual. So that's the two powers, A and B power. They could come from different power supplies. In this case, and in many of these field cases, they didn't. If it was in a central office, they definitely would. And then there is a ground connection down there. Now then, the rest of this block up here is mostly alarm connections, so just relay alarm connections. And then the bottom positions down here were actually a serial port. There is the layout of that connector block in the back. Housekeeping alarms, 1, 2, 3, 4. Those can be defined in the APU to be various different things. And then there are some, there's major, minor alarms over there and a critical alarm, which echo these LEDs here, so you could send that to external equipment. These ones are labeled as audibles, so basically they would power literally a noisemaker if you chose to connect them. This one never had anything connected. Down here we have alarm cutoff output, so that's another relay output saying that the alarm cutoff is activated. I'll talk about that later. And a remote alarm output. And then the rest of these connections were a serial port, transmit, receive, RTS, CTS, DSR, DCD, and DTR, and ground. So you could, as a maintenance tech, connect up to those ones, or the connect the serial port of your laptop up to those ones and talk to this thing for configuration and troubleshooting and whatnot. Or the tech at the far end, more likely, can remotely connect to this thing over the fiber connection. Almost every piece of telecom transport equipment has that capability, that you can remote into it from the far end and say, hey, what's up? What's going on at your end? Let me configure you, all that kind of good stuff. So back at the back there is just a back plane with no intelligence on it to speak of, just a couple of termination resistors and some connectors. So let's yoink these cards out and get back to a more normal view on the desktop here. Okay, let's start looking at this APU card first. So the front panel is fairly typical of telecom equipment. We have three alarm LEDs up here, minor, major, and critical. Minor, something that isn't going to impact the operation of the thing, but you should be aware of. Major is there's something wrong with part of the system, but the whole system isn't completely down. And critical being, we're in major trouble, services are down, the light world is ending, this is horrible. On something like this, minor would probably be things like one of the two power feeds is missing. Something like that. Major would be one of the four T1 outputs or eight T1 outputs is failed or disabled or has some kind of an alarm on it. And critical would be something like the fiber has failed, so everything's down. Something like that. And those alarms are all reported back over the fiber to the far end if it's capable of doing it, if the fiber's not gone. They'll also be reported out, those alarm relays, actually, these alarm relays here, and out to that set of connectors on the back of the shelf. Let's go back to the front panel for just a second. So we have a power and a housekeeping alarm and a remote alarm. That remote alarm is basically, if the card at the far end of this system, on the other end of the fiber, is in alarm for some reason, then this side will show a remote alarm. And conversely, if this side's got an alarm, then the card at the far end will show an alarm on the front of it, which makes it really easy if you've got a whole shelf of these things to walk up and just see which one's got the light on it. Housekeeping alarm will be some of the minor stuff, but also things like the programming is not correct or doesn't make sense and things like that. We have a display remote, so when you push that display remote button, the lights on this side all of a sudden display what the status is on the card on the far end of the system. And a lamp test, which lights up everything on here. ACO, alarm cutoff. So if you do have these audible alarms connected, the relays connected to something that makes noise, you walk into a telecom closet or something and it's chirping at you. You hit the ACO button and it shuts those up.
and lights up the ACO light to just make, let you know that you've, you know, done that. So on the board itself, first we have a 48 volt to 5 volt DC to DC conversion module. If there's anything worth salvaging off here, it may be that. Got a couple of rectifier diodes over there, which are probably just power steering to make sure that, no, not power steering automotive, power, making sure that the power goes in the right way and doesn't cause this thing to be fed with 48 volts the wrong way and subsequently bloated up real good. So here is all the alarm relays, 10 of them, for different output, or for the different outputs that we saw on there. Each one of them is opto-isolated from the rest of the circuit, just to keep things nice and clean by the looks of it. Each one of the relays has its own little drive transistor after the opto-isolators. That's nifty. So what else do we have here? Bunch of resistors feeding the LED input side of these opto-isolators by the looks of it. Some 7400 series logic ICs. Couple of, they look like microcontrollers or microprocessors or something similar to that, with some custom firmware on them, presumably. Okay, I mean, it's not, there's not that much has to go on a board like this, is there? It's just monitoring for alarm conditions coming from other places on the backplane and sending out the alarm outputs. Now then, to the actual reason that this thing exists, we have the QLX card, the quad loop extender card. So what's going on in here? We have a status, we have a remote, so can I talk to the remote or the far end? So we have the status LEDs for the DS1s. These four just show, is it online or not? Is it defined or not? Is it supposed to be in service? Green means online, red means line locked, and off means offline. And these four up here are showing their status, green being okay, red being fault, flashing being it's in a loopback, and off being meaning unequipped or disabled in software. So loopback is a very, very useful testing method for T1s. You can get a piece of equipment to synchronize and go all happy and green if there is a loopback condition. Basically, the two transmits are connected to the two receive, two transmit wires connected to the two receive wires at the other end of the circuit. So that's a very simple troubleshooting method. And all you need is just a jumper or patch cable or something to make that happen. Or you can set loopbacks in software. You can't do it from the front panel, but that's what that serial port that we saw earlier is all about. So here is where the T1 or the fiber connection comes in, transmit and receive. These will be simplex fibers. These are SC connectors, a very standard connector. And this is just a coupler that mechanically holds it. When the fiber is mated, the two faces are in perfect alignment, kind of like that, but held together like that. So actually, if I did this, that would be a loopback on the fiber side. So that fiber goes down in here into, should I take that off? Yeah, I'm going to. Okay, so the fiber comes down onto these two little devices here, optoelectronic devices, one being a laser essentially and one being an optical detector of some description. And then there is some amplification on these two daughter boards, transmit amplification and receive amplification. And that then goes down to the main board. All kinds of manufacturers represented in their supply chain here. We have a DC to DC power module made by Ericsson. Input 38 to 72 volts. Output 5 volts, 6 watts. We have a Motorola chip over here It looks like the big Motorola chip on there and 68302 is the main processor. So this thing is a 68,000 microprocessor. Okay, so this is obviously the brains of the operation. It's got dual UART and serial RS-232. So that will be probably where that serial port on the top connects to, resetting the board and all the rest of that. So that reset pin is probably what's up front.
We have a Xilinx chip over here.
So that Xilinx chip is a field programmable gate array. So more logic, not a processor.
We have an NEC chip over here doing a lot of the heavy lifting. That one is, that's Hitachi, isn't it? Wow, everybody's here. NEC is back here. These, what do we got here? These pulse devices, I think, are matching transformers. Not sure what these NEC devices. Oh, they're relays. They're relays. That will be the relays for doing the individual loopbacks. If you order it a loopback for testing through software, these relays will connect the incoming and outgoing T1 to each other. So these guys here, well, those are transformers. These level one devices here, just judging by their proximity in the circuit, I'm guessing that they are generating the T1 carrier signal. Each one has its own crystal. 973655 is the frequency of that. Interesting. That doesn't relate to the T1 carrier frequency. Ah, there is the main clock frequency for the T1s. 1.544000 megahertz. So that is the T1 frequency. So what the hell are these guys doing then? Okay. Oh, I didn't even notice this one before. There's a Lucent chip down there and a Dallas Semiconductor chip down there. Wow. This is like National Semiconductor. Everybody's around here. Oh, and here is one of that same type of, or a couple of those little same type of, I'm guessing microcontrollers, but maybe they're EEPROMs. Hang on, let me. What do we got here? GAL22-something-10A.
Oh, it's a PLA device. The GAL22V10 series is programmable logic devices from Lattice Semiconductor. Yet another manufacturer on this board.
I always like looking through some of this stuff. I mean, I've seen it at work off and on over the years and often just been curious because I haven't worked on any of these specifically. Just they follow some very standard telecom conventions. So I hope you found that interesting. I certainly enjoyed doing that. Yeah, if you got any comments or questions, if you've worked with these things in the past, or if you actually worked for ADC down in Minneapolis, jump in the comments and say hi. Thanks again. I'll talk to you later.